Shall we say a word of prayer quickly? Father, tonight we're at your feet, and in this few minutes we trust in that you will speak to our hearts. There are many things happening in our world. We have no clue. We don't absolutely understand, but we come in humility to hallow your name. Lord, we are excited about what you are doing in this place, the prayers, the testimonies, the lives of people, though coming out of prison and being met at the gate and giving us a foretaste of how God will meet us at the gates of heaven. Lord, it's exciting what is happening. It's like heaven is on earth right here. And Lord, that gives me a lot of excitement every Thursday night, showing up with people who love radically. They don't even care where I come from, the sin I've committed, the crimes on me and my culture and my creed and my background. And Lord, I can just feel the love. And I'm excited to be here today, Lord. I pray that you will speak to us to keep this hope, this living hope, this radical hope. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm talking about hope alive. But I would do a quick thing. You know, when I was here, I came to the state about, let's say, to school about a year, about 60 months ago. And then a friend invited me to RTO. This was in September. I think it was your brother or someone. You actually drove us that night. Kyoko from Kenya and me and I think one other guy. We had a good time here. This is last year. But after I left, it's like, wow. All these people talking about prison and they're talking about preparing people for prison and are they trying to say that I'm going to go in prison myself? Really, I was a bit scared. Coming from Africa, it's like, well, the next thing I may find hanging out with these people, as a black guy in a white community, they may just take me up to prison. Seriously, I did not come back to RTO again. I was scared. I'm sorry, I confess today. But you see, over the course of my learning, and this is a true story, I'm not making this up. I've been here before. This is about June. I participated in a conference, which the school encouraged most students to do, and it was called Justice Conference in the city. And I met this wonderful woman I call now my mother, Jenny. Can you wave, Jenny? And so Jenny and me started talking. And Jenny just had radical love. Now I have my words right. Radical love for me and started introducing me. So she helps me to go to participate in Willow Creek Leadership Summit in August. And I think about 2 weeks or so after, somewhere late August, September, she calls me. And because of the mother role, she can call me like 5 o'clock. Can you be here at 6 o'clock? And I said, wow, man. And now I'm in school, I'm studying, I can't come. He says, no, this place they pray. I know you love to pray. I says, where? And then I came here. So that was really my second time of coming. But you see, what made the difference this time? Maybe two things quickly. Is that over the years, or over the month studying in Whedon, I had a new understanding of the gospel. See, that's why I stood up to hug the brother. See, before I came to America, my gospel message was very narrowed. It was just to preach salvation and don't care about the kingdom. And so, yes, I see Jesus hang out with tax collectors and prostitutes, but I just felt that was them and that was Jesus. But my message is like, okay, I go to colleges and I speak to students. So it's like, that's my ministry. My ministry is to young people. It's not to prisoners. Over the last 10 months in my study of evangelism, I was blown. The gospel is for prisoners first. Jesus came right from baptism in Luke chapter 4, and Jesus had a mission statement. Luke chapter 4, verse 19. Is there a way to put the scripture up? There's not? I have to use this? I'm going to read it quickly. I think I left my Bible somewhere. Excuse me, I will just do this quickly and we'll go into it. Thank you. If you don't mind, you have a Bible open, because this is what I'm going to talk about. And I'll be with you soon. Luke chapter 4, verse 19. If Bob was here or Wolf, he would have quoted it straight for me, and today he's not here. I got to open it. All right. Thank you. Thank you. Luke chapter 4, verse 19. This is what the word of the Lord says. I'm starting from 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel, one, to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to prisoners, to captives. This is Jesus. I've read this many times. I did not understand. And sometimes we explain it away. Oh, maybe to spiritual prisoners. But prisoners are prisoners. And in fact, I just realized that I was in prison. Do you know what my prison was? Thinking I'm better than others. There are a lot of people who are in prison. We call it self-imprisonment. Because they have so much elevated their very self above others. As I go down my slide, you will see what real prison is. This is what Jesus came to do. What RTO has helped me in the last 2 months to really appreciate with what I'm studying is that perhaps my school gives me theory. Radical Timeout, the Koinonia House Ministry, gives me practicum, practical. It makes the gospel comes alive. It's one thing to study in an institution about gospel to prisoners, and it's another thing hanging out around with prisoners. And I think my education is not complete until I can sit face to face with Doug and love him like a brother coming out of prison. That is when I see the gospel has impacted my life. The fact that I'm afraid, and like many people do, and shy away, it just means that the gospel, the kingdom is not within me. And that's a hard statement to make, but that is the truth. Now let's go to substantive issues here. This is just my introduction. So a few days ago, I had my 9th anniversary, and I'm really thankful to God. My wife and daughter back in Accra, Ghana. God willing, in about a month's time, I will see them. And I just wanted to thank God that all of you here have been my brothers, my sisters, and my family. And I want to celebrate that with you. God willing, I am attending Abana. It's a conference in St. Louis for college students. And then I go to Ghana. Some people are asking, what am I going to do? These are things that God has been placing on my heart in the last few months as I'm reflecting. New paradigm for churches to engage prisons. See, my church has been involved in prison ministry, as in going there to preach. I have never gone. It's changed from now. We're going to prison Tuesday on Dixon Prison. Oh, put your hands together for the Lord. These are things that I'm trusting now. The church back in Ghana will begin to understand what it means to engage prisons. And not just my church. And so when you are praying for me, this is an area. I want as many churches to be open to this gospel, which I have come to understand because of RTO. I still want to work with the young people to have meaning in their lives, in dignity of work, and if possible, to help them not to go to prison. So yes, we will go there to solve problems, but perhaps we can also put prevention to a lot of them from getting there. Over the few months here, I've had opportunity to understand really myself well, to know that I wasn't saved out of abortion, and many asked me to share this a bit because some of you are new. Back in 1978, my mom was a high schooler. It's a bit of my story in 2 minutes. And she was pregnant. My culture is honor and shame. If you don't have a husband and you're pregnant, it's a dishonor to the family. So usually what will happen is that you are thrown out of the house because you've brought disgrace to the family. My mom wanted to avoid all that. So she quickly looked for means to solve the disgrace by trying to do abortion. Abortion is illegal in my country. So in 78, my mom, as smart as she could do, was to find herbs, concoctions, those African stuff. You know, you take it and within days, as she was told, it will induce the abortion. My mom says she took it for one whole month. See, Scott, this is what I have faith that we can pray for your daughter. Because my mom knew the concoctions and the herbs she took, I was not going to end up as a good child. She went over to get orthodox medicine, like over-counter drugs that can induce abortion. She took that for also another 1 month. It was supposed to be 1 week, and it will induce. After a week, second, third, it didn't happen. My mom was tired of this baby that will not come out. So she runs to a big city 4 hours away from where she was living, look for an abortion doctor, and says, look, I have done this. I know this baby is not going to end up well because I've taken a lot of herbs, I've taken a lot of drugs. Please, can you help me abort this child? The doctor says, you are 5 months pregnant. Says, what? I thought it's 3 months. He says, 5 months. I'm going to need your mom, that's my grandmother, to sign some document because I am not sure it will be safe. So if you can get your mom to sign, I will do the abortion. I thank God for many grandmothers here who pray for their wayward children. Yeah. Don't give up when your child goes wayward or becomes rebellious. Keep praying. That's what my grandmother did. And so the abortion doctor could not do that. And that's why I'm standing here today. So it gives me a ministry right here. I'm going back to Ghana with a fresh understanding of the gospel to women at risk who are being sucked out of their homes and who don't have places to stay to have their babies. That instead of thinking of abortion, we want to give you an option to deliver. And Jonathan has been wonderful. Jonathan has 4 kids already. That's why we become good friends. He just went to Uganda about a month ago to adopt his failed child. 4 American daughters. Now he has a son from Uganda. They are still processing. And if you want to pray for Jonathan, that is an area they are now waiting for the court ruling to have their Ugandan son join. The wife and 4 daughters are in Uganda right now as I'm talking. And this is what gives me hope, that every Christian family in Ghana can think of adoption. I heard what the brother said. He said, we've been adopted. You were just speaking to me. Today it's like the Holy Spirit has just ordered everything. Adoption. These kids don't need to be in orphanage. If you ask me in a simple term, what is my dream? 0%. In the next 10 years, I don't want any orphanage to have kids. I want these kids to have families. Every kid deserves a family. Pray for me. These are things that God has placed on my heart. So God's protection, strategic partnership with churches, favor with government agencies, and resources to move on. These are areas you can pray for me if you're praying for me going to Ghana next month. And hope one day we can do our own RTO and money will come with Scott to come and preach. All right. Now I'm here to do my sermon in 15. Please help me with my time. What do you like about Christmas? Now I'm trying to preach. What do you like about Christmas? Some people say they love the family coming together. They love the gifts. Right? I love the gift too. But have you thought about that if you are not so much in tune or in good terms and relationship with people, you can't give them gift. Or you don't even feel like giving them gift. Or you feel like they will not accept your gift. Though sometimes you can make the effort. So, at Christmas, God gave us a gift. Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. I will not read now. It says that, and your son will be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. This is really the summary of the Christmas message. God gave us a gift. What really is this gift about? People say it's Jesus Christ. Others say it's the forgiveness of sin. Others say it's the hope of the world. But that's what we are here to find out. So I'm talking about hope alive. And I check quick definitions and it's like, oh, it's a feeling that which is wanted can be had, or that event will turn out for the best. That's hoping. English definition from dictionaries. This is an evangelical Christian dictionary. It said to trust in, wait for, look for, or desire something or someone, or to expect something beneficial in the future. That's cool, right? But so what is the big idea about hope? You see, in the beginning, I call it how God defined hope. He gave us everything right in the garden. Genesis chapter 2, he made man and woman after his own kind. And he says, I want to dwell with you. I want to be in relationship. That was the hope. That God will show up in the cool of the day and he can have a conversation with Adam and he can check up on how Adam is doing and Adam check up on God. And they were cool dudes. You know what I'm talking about. This is what God really wanted, right from the beginning. That was the hope God had for mankind and mankind had for God, that they could be in good terms. But hope derailed. Someone showed up and he says, you know, all this thing God is trying to do up with you is fishy, it's fake, it's not real. Have you heard those conversations before? When you're trying all you can to be in good terms with people, to love them, to care for them, and somehow they hear a strange voice. Sometimes even in marriage, and you begin to hear from friends, do you think your husband is showing all this love? Is it not because he's up to something? Or do you think your wife is becoming all this nice? Is it not up to something? And then they sow doubt. And that the doubt finds a way to derail the beautiful relationship that allows you to hope that your husband really loves you as he says. And sometimes children doubt the authenticity of the love of their parent. And so they begin to confide in their friends and hope and begin to rebel against their own parent. And hope is derailed. Hope. So you see, if you look into Jeremiah chapter 31, and I'm not reading because I know my time, but I'm just trying to quote, and these are references for those of us who want to read further. God has been trying to make this hope a reality. And so God, in his ultimate power, would send, would take families like Abraham. He says, see, I want to work a work in you. I want to make a blessing out of you. Abraham, I really care about my wealth, but I'm not finding a man. Will you be available so that I can build a relationship? I want to have a covenant with you. I want to be like what Adam used to be. I want to bless you. I want to be with you again. And so he began to talk about his plan. And so he says, look, your people will go into slavery and they will feel like I have forgotten about them. And it will feel like 400 years, God is not real. And sometimes in our own walk with God, it comes to a place where we just feel like God is so far away. Sometimes I pray and it's like my prayer just hit the ceiling. And it's like, where is God? And so the people cried out, and Moses will show up right in the wilderness, have an encounter with God. And God says, you know something? I have been right where you are. This is a holy place. Will you take your shoes? And I just want to spend time with you, Moses. I just want to be with you, Moses. I've been looking out for you since you showed up here to be the shepherd and run away as a fugitive. And by the way, Moses was like a prisoner running away as a murderer. No, you can't talk about the Bible without talking about prisons. There's no way. See, that is how ignorant I have been and running away from RTO from beginning. Many people, when you talk prison ministry, they shy away. Please be patient with your ignorance, because perhaps they have not read the Bible like I thought I had. Moses was a fugitive. I read in my book like he was talking about Moses. I said, he was run away like, he said, man, he says, like I was running away from the FBI. Moses, God says, I want to do something. So he started talking about, there is hope. I want to restore these people. I want to come into relationship. I'm going to take them out of Egypt. We're going to the promised land. And all we're going to do is that I want to be your God. And I want you to be my people. That's really what I want. I want to love you radically. You don't have to do anything. I want to fight Pharaoh. I will fight the enemy. I will take you from the land. You are prisoners. You are slaves in Egypt, but I love you and I care. And see, there is no way you can talk about this Bible without understanding what it means to be in prison. And I value everyone here who has been to prison before, because you have something that I wish I have. You understand the Bible better than I do. You don't know what God has allowed you to go through. It's an experience people love to have. Sometimes they don't even know why they need it. I'm not glorifying prison. I'm just trying to tell you that this scripture is full of prison stories. And take prisons out of scripture, you have just two covers and nothing in. That's what I'm discovering. That's what I'm hanging out here. I'm learning from every one of you. Whether your family member is in prison, whether you have been to prison, it's not a new story. I just want you to know that God is with the prisoner, and God is with the slave. God is with the brokenhearted. God was with the underdog. God is with the people with issues. That's what I'm discovering over. And that's what I said, I have been too prideful, thinking they are there and I'm here. I have been a Pharisee and I didn't even know that I was called so. But the Bible says so. But that's really the whole thing. And so every prophet who came wanted to talk about God is with you. But you see, that was not enough. So that was hope declared. But you see, after a while, God says, no, this plan ain't working well. I want to put my word in their heart. I want to show up. Maybe they've seen the prophet, they couldn't get it. Maybe they've seen the miracles, they couldn't get it. Sometimes God wants to get your attention. I heard what the brother just said. Doug was talking about God has been searching for me to have a relationship with me. And all I kept doing was running. And I ran from God every day. And God keep pursuing me. Pursuing. And sometimes God will pursue you to prison. It's his plan. It doesn't look cool. But he really has good intentions. But that's what God did here. And so he sent Jesus. He came, Emmanuel. He says, I am with you now. You see, this time it's not about prophet. It's not about miracles. It's not about the signs and the works of God. It is God showing up all by himself. Emmanuel, God is with us. This is a Christmas story. You can talk about the other things. But I'm seeing that it's all about hope with us. Declared. It's here. You see, and so when Jesus was leaving, he says, you guys, I want you to go to the rest of the world. Go talk about this hope. And do you know what he said in verse 20? I know we do the great commandment, but we end somewhere. Today, let's read it. That'll be the only scripture maybe I read. If you don't mind, we'll read Matthew chapter 28, and then we'll do verse 18 to 20. But look at something interesting here, and I'm coming to the end. I will soon be done. Please be with me. Matthew 28 is like the last chapter of Matthew. Oh my, I love this scripture. Okay, I think I found it somewhere here. So Jesus is now telling the people what's supposed to happen. And then he said, Jesus came and spoke to them. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe things that I have commanded you. This is where we usually end. Today, let me just let you know that that is not the end of the story. You know, sometimes you get to the part of your life, and you think you've seen it all. You think it's all that God can ever do. But sometimes you just need to take time and see there's one line. Tell someone there's one line after the great commandment. There's one line there. It's quite interesting. I just saw that. I've read it, but I didn't know what it really meant. But look at this. If you have a Bible, you can underline. Say, lo, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I'm with you always. See, I'm excited about great commandment. I want to go make disciples. But I had not taken note of this. So sometimes we want to work hard. We want to try by ourselves. We want to get the seven steps, the five methods, the appropriate methods and ideas, the theology. They are good. But no, really what makes the difference is this one. It says, and lo, I am with you always, even. See, that's hope there. That's the word. He said, I want to be with you. It's not about what you teach and what you're going around to talk about. And sometimes churches have fought over doctrines and have fought over who has the right Calvinist idea or has the right Arminian thought. But it's not really about the theology. God says, I am with you. No, sometimes you feel so low and you think you don't even know much in scripture to pray. And sometimes you don't even have the right words to say in prayer. Just remember, I am with you always. Really, that's the message. So when Paul was doing the epistles from prison, you know that most of the 13 books Paul wrote, he was in prison, right? A lot of you know about that. The people who read Paul's epistles who don't like prisoners, you know, it was written from prison. It's a good place. Oh, no, in the world it's very bad. But if you know Christ and you're in prison, you are not really in prison. You know why? Because Christ is in you. Colossians 1:26-27. And the sum of that verse is that Christ in you is the hope of glory. And sometimes I didn't understand that. It sounded okay, but I said, what does that mean? Christ in me, the hope of glory. Please think about that for a minute. There is a story in Judges. The man is called Gideon. Gideon was treading wheat in a wine press. See, when you want to thresh wheat, and everybody who is done in some agrarian society, you know that you need to be in an open environment so the air can blow the chaff away. But you know, because of what was going around, the Philistines, the oppression, the imprisonment they had in their own land, Gideon was threshing wheat in a wine press. He said, when you are doing wine, you don't want much exposure to air because of oxidation. You want to keep it low, so it's like a cave. But you find a man like Gideon who is threshing wheat in a wine press. It always sounds like oxymoron. No, sometimes in the part of your own life, even after you become Christian, this is what I want you to reflect on. There is a disconnect. There is a disconnect because you still live in fear. You still can't hope that life is going to be better. And sometimes you hear things, the enemies are coming, the Philistines are coming. And that was the issue of Gideon in this whole thing. But do you know what happened? So an angel of the Lord showed up one day to Gideon and he says, thou mighty man of valor. I'm talking to someone here. Sometimes God shows up to you, says, thou mighty woman of valor, of vigor, of purpose, of hope, of mission. It's like, God, are you talking to me? Is there somebody else here? It's unfortunate I don't have time to go, but sometimes I love the drama. Can you spare me? How am I doing with time? Please, I'm very concerned. I want to respect the American time. I'm an African preacher, and sometimes I need help. I need grace from you. That is why I'm watching it. I want us to read this. Maybe it will bless someone. It's in Judges chapter 6. I put it there in case we just have to, you know, we couldn't read it. Let me just read one verse for you. And I want to show you how God put hope in the midst of the mess. In the midst of what you don't understand. Doc, you just came out of prison and you think, how is life going to be out? And sometimes you don't need to figure it out. Every American has this word, oh, we got to figure it out. Sometimes you just don't have to figure it out. You just have to pray and let God figure it out for you. I mean, sometimes you really can't figure it out because you don't have what it takes to figure it out. Judges chapter 6, verse 11. And now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the tree in Ophrah, which belonged to Joash of Israel, while the son Gideon threshed wheat. Listen, threshed wheat in the wine press. That really caught my attention. Threshed wheat in the wine press. What are you really caught up doing right now in your life? Is that really where God wants you to be? Or you are doing it because you have to pay the bills and you are living in fear because you have mortgage. And sometimes you are struggling as to do what God has really called you to do because there are Philistines, there are enemies, there are voices around you. And you find a man like Gideon threshing wheat in a wine press. And the angel of the Lord appeared and said to him, the Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor. Gideon said to him, oh my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has this thing happened to us? Where are all his miracles which our fathers told us about? Saying, did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? Thank you.
Did the Lord not bring us out of Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us. That the Lord turned to him and said, go in this your might. I want you to know something tonight. That it is not really where you are now. And if even it's your own choices, your mistakes that got you there. I just want you to know that God says, I'm with you. Now, that is what he told them. He said, go this in your might, for I am. You can check that out. Up to 17. So when God says he's with you, the situation may look very awkward. In fact, it could be that you don't know when your loved one is coming back from prison. But you see, when Joseph was in prison, another man I love, Joseph was in prison, right? And the Lord was with him. That's what makes the difference. And the Lord was what? Was with Joseph, right in the prison. And everybody he trusted had forgotten. He helped people to get back to their job. And when they got to the king and they were seven, they had forgotten Joseph. But the Lord was with Joseph. The Lord was with Gideon. So do you know why prison is as painful as death? It is because both bring separation from the people we love. One brings separation for a short time. The latter brings separation for a longer time. Stop. Think and reflect. What about separation for eternity? And if you take radical prayer, the book, you know, my mommy said something interesting. He said, you see, it is better to be ready to go to heaven from prison than to be on the streets and go to hell. Because that's eternal separation. Right in radical prayer. Think about it. Separation. God wants to be with us. We want to be away from him. When you're put in prison, you've been put away from your family. The separation. That's the common thing there. And God says, I am with you, even in prison, even to the end of the age. I have looked at the news. I have listened. And some of you are aware. Send the California shooting, the Paris. And it's happening in Africa. I listen to news. 5 minutes. Thank you. And I just heard this. I follow the news closely. And everything I'm getting is helplessness and hopelessness. So what is God's response? This is where I'm ending. Quick. To keep hope alive is to know that God is with you in good times and bad times. You know, sometimes we think God goes on vacation. That is why we get into bad times. So when there is shooting in Paris, do you know what everybody starts to hashtag? Pray for Paris. So once again, in radical prayer, many will talk about we treat God as a paramedic. It's only when there are crises. But you see, God has always been there. It is we who run away from him. If you want to keep hope alive, you need to have this mindset that God never left. In fact, Jesus said, I have come to dwell, to tabernacle with man. God is in us. Right? Two, to keep hope alive is to hold on to God's unchanging word. Paul said that for the promises of God are yea and amen in Christ Jesus. So it doesn't matter where you are now. It could be Gideon in a wine press. It could be Joseph forgotten in prison for doing what is good. We know people sinned and committed errors and got into prison. But we also know some, it's no fault of theirs that they got into prison. So stop judging people who went to prison because you don't know their story. And to keep hope alive is to hope against hope. There was a man called Abraham, and I won't have time to talk about him, but he was so old, and God had promised him he's going to have a son. At the point, Bible says he had to hope against hope. Maybe it's where, that's where you are now. You don't really see possibility of coming out of what you're going through. And sometimes you don't even feel whether these prayers we pray here will work for you. But a man called Abraham, he's called the father of faith. At a time in his life, he had to get to that place and says, I have to hope against hope. It's right in the Bible, in Romans chapter 4. He hoped against hope. And to keep hope alive is to keep focused on the glory of God. You remember what I talked about? I said that Christ in you is the hope of that glory. And when you take time in Romans chapter 8 and do the breakdown, I said the whole creation is in crying, is in pain, and is waiting for the adoption of God's son. And hope is not hope when we see it. Anything you have, you can't hope for it. And that's why we keep hoping. Because we know one of these days, the prayer of our brother will come, where we will be received at the gate of heaven. And that is a big welcome. I love that prayer. And I love this John Wesley. So it's the captain of Israel's host. He said, our strength is your grace, our rule your word, and our end is the glory of the Lord. If you don't see the glory of God in your state right now, you have not come to your end.
It's not your end. If you look where you are now and it's not the glory of God, really, that is not your end. Because God's glory must come to pass in your life. Really, that is the end. That is Christ in you, the hope of glory. That is what gives us hope. So if the situation is bad, that means God is not finished with you yet. He's still work in progress. To keep hope alive, Luke 18 verse 1. He said, men ought always to pray so that they will not give up. You see, that is my bottom line. If you stop praying, you've stopped hoping. Just like man who says, you cannot love without praying. I also believe that you cannot pray without hope. If you pray and you don't have hope, you are not praying. It's almost like Jesus said, if people stop praying, they've stopped hoping. He said, men ought to pray and not to give up. Men ought to pray and not to be discouraged. Men ought to pray. You see, with prayer, we keep the communication link between our God, our Father. And like I want to borrow many words again, to hallow his name on earth and stay informed. Because he wants to be with us. And sometimes we don't know what God is doing because we have not opened the prayer line. We are just complaining around it. Sometimes we talk for 30 minutes and pray for 5 minutes. But how can you not pray in our world today? And I guess that's where I end. How can you? Can you bow down your head with me? My time is up. How can you not pray today? The only way to keep hope alive in the midst of the chaos, in the midst of the mess, in the midst of your challenge, in the midst of what it looks like transition that never ends, in the midst of whether prison is going to be good or bad, whether my family in prison is going to be well, it is hoping against hope. But you cannot but to pray. You cannot. Just close your eyes with me as I definitely come. I want to pray for you. I'm leaving for Ghana. I might not speak again. Next week will be our last meeting for the year, and you might not see me again. But I want to leave you with a prayer, and I'll be praying for you, and I pray that you pray for me. Father in heaven, I thank you for everyone under the sound of my voice who's heard me talk about hope. And that's what you have given us, to be with us. And you have promised you will be with us. When we go through the fire, when we go through the waters, it will not overwhelm us. And sometimes, really, Lord, we are overwhelmed with everything happening around us, with our finances, with our future, with our marriage, with our kids, Lord, with our city, with our laws. Lord, with what's happening in the global scale from France and the ISIS and refugees. Lord, we want to keep hope alive in the midst of all this. And so we want to ask for grace to pray, grace to stay informed to the heavenly call. May we not give up in the midst of it, because we know that our light affliction worketh for us a great and great reward. And that is what we hope for. And that is why we do not give up. And so, Lord, we pray that we will hold on, even when we don't feel like holding on, that we will hope and hope and hope. Lord, I pray for a radical hope. In our lives, Lord, in our ministries, and in our future. In the name of Jesus, amen. Brother, I'm sweating.
No, we'll stay.
Oh, sorry.
No, that's okay.
Okay. Wow, that was awesome. I'm so glad you decided to bless us. And I want to take the time to pray for you, but also just very quickly, as the pastor heart in me, I'm so proud of you guys in this room. Do you just realize what you did? You impacted Africa here.
Yes.
I mean, I don't think you understand what you've done.
No, it's huge.
People pray, Lord, how can we impact people over there? And you did it.
Yes.
By being you. I'm so proud to be associated with you.
Yeah.
I'm so proud.
It's an opportunity. It's a privilege.
To know you.
Yes.
I am so proud that you listen to crazy people like Manny, Barbara, and myself. I am beyond humbled by what God, through the Holy Spirit, has done through you.
Yes, yes.
Being honest, being scarred, and being willing to love even though you are scarred.
Yeah. I love you people, I love you, yeah.
So I'm gonna bless our brother, yes. But as a quick announcement, we don't actually have to put away the tables. We just have to put away the chairs and clear off the tables today. So just so you know, and then I just wanna bless our brother here. Yes. Father God, sometimes all I can do is just say, wow, you are so good at being God. Thank you for sending us this brother. Thank you for his willingness to be honest that he was kind of scared of us. And thank you for your love that overcomes fear. So my brother, there's a lot of logistics ahead of Kingsley. Finances, getting stuff, starting ministries. Father, it can probably feel overwhelming.
Oh, yes. I'm hoping.
Give my brother peace.
Amen.
May the shalom of yes. God overwhelm my brother so that everyone that bumps into him bumps into you. Father God, prepare his path back to Ghana. And Father, we thank you that in Christ, this is only the beginning. This is not the end.
Yes.
So Lord, we look forward to hearing what you're going to do through Kingsley and in Ghana through him. And Lord, thank you for how he's impacted us. It's not a one-way street. It's gone both ways. So Father God, may you continue to bless him, encourage him, keep him safe, have mercy upon him, and give him peace. And through the power of your Holy Spirit, guide his steps each and every day. I ask this in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.